exactly as he or she would want to, but and the other may not be there. But as students of history, friends, you'll have to understand that other is often there in a very covert way. Let me just give you an example of Vedic corpus. Now, Vedic corpus, we all know, are the Vedas are the work of Vedic Aryans and a small section of the Vedic Aryans. But do we get references to others also? Because we do not have views of what, say, the Chalcolithic, Neolithic people had to say of that time. But if you were to read very carefully the Vedas, we do find in between lines, there is the othering process that is happening. You're talking about the other who is generally demonized, ridiculed, put on the margins. But we get that notion, and you have to be trained to cull that material out. Yes, every author writes with biases. Even when I, as a student of history, would make a claim that I'm going to write something which is absolute objective history, the way Ramke would want us to write. But no, I'm also located in a certain kind of setup, and my biases will start coming in. And you, as a researcher, will have to locate me in that scenario and also understand why the biases are there. We do get a sense of interpolation, deletions, annotations in numerous versions of texts, and this becomes pertinent for the text that I am making use of, and that is the Mahabharata. Because it was a text that became very popular across the Indian subcontinent, got translated in so many languages, is still very, very popular. And for us, then there is the responsibility of stratifying our text. You know, stratification is taking one layer after another, one layer after another. We have to place. But even these layers that come over a particular core story are of great importance to us, because we as students of history learn when and where to relate the text to the original source, or probably that particular layer to a particular milieu. And then for that, for us, it is reflective of the viewpoints of that society. This is very, very important. At times, who's controlling the transmission of those texts also becomes very evident to us. I must also acknowledge that apart from the Mahabharata, there are so many other texts that speak of the ideal king, like the Arthashastra, the Manusmriti, and Buddhist texts, which I will have to take into context. Not today, not in our presentation here, but if we are writing a paper, then I'll have to take other texts also, at least mention them, because Mahabharata is not the only text that talks about the ideal king. So coming to my source, so point one, I have told you the kind of queries that I have in mind, importance of the textual material. Next, I have to explain what my source is. My textual source is the Mahabharata, so I should be able to apprise the reader of where do I place Mahabharata. I know it's a very complex text which has new elements superimposed on it. We know that it has at least three layers, the Jaya Sahita, the Bharat Sahita, the Mahabharata, 8,800 verses, 24,000 verses, 99,000 verses, which finally gets Sanskritized around the Gupta period. It must have actually emerged as a part of the oral tradition, a popular folklore, which had legends, dramatized stories, eulogic songs, which are called gathas, narshansis, akhyans, kathas. But then eventually it becomes a part of a kavya and an epic. It is translated in so many languages and in so many regional languages also. But the text that I am making use of course, it is ascribed to one individual. We know it's Ved Vyas. But the compilation time of this particular text, of the story itself, at least runs beyond 800 years. 4th century BCE to 4th century CE. So which is the version that I'm using as my base book? I'll have to tell the authors. I use a critical edition of the Bhandarkar Oriental Research Center, Pune, and which was edited by Suktankar. It was almost a 40 years enterprise, starting sometimes in 30s. And it is very interesting. It gives you the core story and also its versions, all versions as footnotes. You know, what comes in this particular story comes like this. And in Kashmiri, in the Sharda version, the Shantiniketan version, these are all different versions mentioned right there. Now, epics have an advantage over, say, the Shrot, corpus, for instance, the Vedas, because epics cut across class and gender divide, reach out to a wider audience, which the Vedas would never deliberately not do. The Vedic, the Brahmins would not let it become a part of a popular culture. The result then is that epics reflect societies and numerous philosophical strands that must have dominated philosophical thinking, popular culture at a point in time and in different locales. And from our point of view, when we're talking about an ideal king, so the concept of an ideal king is there at the popular level, the concept is there at the normative level also. The only thing is for early India, by and large, the text that we managed to get Sanskritized. So in the sense, the final version is more like a polished version. The advantage of studying the Mahabharata, especially in relation to this particular concept, friends, was that the Mahabharata provides us both the theory as well as the practical application of the concept of kingship. Now, you know, the Mahabharata has 18 parvas, right from, you know, Adi Parv to the Swarga Arohan Parv. There are 18 parvas, and in each of these parvas or the books, or you have the concept of kingship, and the two which are otherwise very important, the didactic sections, are the 12th and 13th, that is the Shanti Parva and the Anushasan Parva. So interestingly, we have ideas which are running throughout, but these ideas may be overlapping in consonance with the theory, they may go completely against the theory. So this is as far as my, you know, I have once again made clear what is going to be my source. So when you are writing, sources are very important. They have to be put together, and they have the nature of the sources, the expansive time frame. Everything has to be explained to the reader. Now, after that, what happens? And friends, I'm here really sharing my experience of conducting research. A bunch of queries came into one's mind. When we started working, I'm talking of 30 years back, we did not have computers or laptops, so I used to just make use of pen, paper, register, pick up a register, and whatever random questions are coming in your mind, just start writing down in different pages, which would assist me. If I'm taking this as a theme of ideal king, it will help me trace certain attributes of it. So the questions that came to my mind when I started preparing for this particular presentation, I'm just listing those down. What really was the domain of the king? Could he be synonymously identified with the state, or was state a larger entity and he an executioner of its polity? Point two, was the possession and display of physical strength and aggression integral to a king's persona best exhibited on the battlefield? Friends, I'm not able to see you, but am I clear? I mean, are you able to understand what I'm saying? I can't see any reaction.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So, in other words, was the possession of brute force or association with violence? Violence is so important when you talk about kingship. Was it normalized as an essential attribute of the ruler, especially in a bid to expand your empire, or sometimes in a bid to access resources? Similarly, was shaming the opponent, especially by targeting women folk, considered to be typical of a powerful king? Okay, was the squeezing of tax from the populace considered the right of a king, especially as he had to consolidate the financial base of his state? On the other hand, did compassion and humility delineate his persona? That means, are the notions of kingship and ethics compatible? Was providing an heir to the empire considered a central duty of the king? Do normative and narrative traditions point out a difference between the kings being procreative and a king being lustful? Did hunting, gambling, indulgence, and pleasure with women define the character of a manly king? Was the possession of beauty, you know, good looks, crucial to the construct of a powerful hegemonic king? How far was genealogical support required for a king's success? And what role does approximation to divinity play in defining the king? Now, this is exactly, you know, I just picked up pen, paper, I started writing whatever I thought were essential attributes. Now, once I have done that, random thinking, the next exercise is that I have some 11, 12 questions. I'll have to try and put them into broad attributes, 3 or 4. You know, can put them under the head. For instance, I would first look at the issue of identity. Under the head of identity, I can talk about establishing genealogy, association of the king with divinity, concept of beauty associated with him, and the need to ensure lineage. So that's one broad category which I can look at. The second, whenever I talk about ensuring the lineage, another idea gets intertwined with it, the idea of virility and fertility associated with the king in person. Especially king is not just a man, he is the most important man. Next, the third thing is the association of king with violence, control of brute force, complete control on the army, aggrandizement of the land, maintenance of law and order and use of violence there, collection of revenue, and more than that, shaming the opponent. So violence can be used for so many things, maintenance of peace, maintain aggrandizement, law and order, collection of revenue, and shaming the other, the opponent. And just in contrast to that, the issue of compatibility between ethics, you know, I'm looking at around the ethics around peace and kingship. So these were the issues that came to my mind, which I have noted down. Then I kind of put them in broad categories. Now I come to the Mahabharata, to the text. So imagine I started working on it, but it's step-by-step movement. It's not something that you start, you just pick up Mahabharata and start doing it. No, a lot of brainstorming has to go before that. Now I first pick up the issue of identity. So in my register, I'll first pick up the page on identity and start looking through the text. Where should I look at it? Now the identity is associated with genealogy, as well as the ability to carry on lineage. Now, in the context of the Mahabharata and the Bharat dynasty, we know that the absence of an heir led to the establishment of what is called the concept of Apada Dharma, or the law of exigency, where a woman, in case her husband died young or was impotent, she was made to cohabit with another man, but with the consent of the in-laws, and the child that was be born out of it with this niyog arrangement would be given the name of the legal father and not the biological father. So what happens? You know, Satyavati, Shantanu fell in love with Satyavati, and one of the agreement points of agreement at the time of the marriage was that the child born out of Satyavati and Shantanu would be the successor. And that's when Bhishma takes the vow of celibacy. He's the elder brother, he's the elder son of Shantanu. But Satyavati got worried after the death of her son, Vichitravir, and wondered what will happen to the Bharat dynasty because there's no heir. And so she requests Bhishma to cohabit with the daughter-in-laws. Bhishma just refused to do that because he has taken a vow of celibacy. And then he shows them the way of Niyog. Now, I have picked up a particular, passage from the Adi Parva. That's 197 and 9-11, exact passage. I just want to read that out to you and tell you how are you going to cull historical information out of it. Now, what is it that Satyavati tells Bhishma? The ancestral oblation to famous Shantanu of the Kurus, who always abode by Dharma and his frame and his progeny now all rest with you because he's the elder son. Even as heaven is sure, when one has done good acts, even as life, long life is sure when truth has been obeyed. I see the procedure in distress, and this is a long dialogue, I've just cut it short. I see the procedure in distress as securely lodged with you. That is, you are going to make a difference. I enjoin you a task. My mighty son was your brother, and he was dear to you. A young man still, he went to heaven, leaving no sons. Your brothers, queens and daughters of the king of Kashi in youth, and they yearn for sons. Bharat, beget children on them, beget them at my behest. Pray, carry out dharma which applies here. Be consecrated as the king of the realm. Rule the Bharatas, take a wife, or else you drown your forebears. Now, interesting. Now, after you've read this little passage, just a short passage, there's so many points of postulation that come out of it. First of all, we do get to know about the genealogy. We know there is a Bharat clan. We know that the dynasty is a Kuru dynasty, and now it is heirless, and there's a need to act immediately so that the lineage continues under these dire circumstances. We also get to know the genealogy of the princes here, that is the Kashi princes, who are going to be the mothers to future kings. We are told that when Dharma is not working, you can actually resort to Apada Dharma. Again, what for what reason? Sustenance of one's identity. We also get to know how the issue of identity gets intertwined with obligations towards ancestors. So you have to do the Pindadan. Till you do the Pindadan, your ancestors are going to remain unsettled. Now, interestingly, this very rationale of identity becomes the reason for Pandu to he pushes his wives, both Kunti and Madhuri, into niyog relations, as this would grant him a seat in heaven. Because without Pindadan, nobody gets a secure position in heaven. But with Pandu, it's another thing. This is the issue of identity. But Pandu's identity brings in, or his airing of his troubles, bring in a critique of this issue of identity. So somewhere there is the need to establish the rule, establish the lineage, the identity is based on it, but poor Pandu, he feels very unsettled by this. He gets into a dialogue with Kunti, and he wants Kunti to go in for a niyog arrangement because he can't reproduce. And Kunti is desisting. That is when he tells, pours her his heart out to her. And he says, and this is again in the first Mahabharat Adi Parv itself, says, my father, sired by an eternally righteous man, Shantanu, came to an end of his life, though still a child, because of his lustful nature. He underlines that point. And he says, so we heard. Because Vichitraveer was one who was given to gambling and to, you know, lusting after women, really not paying heed. And then he fell ill also and eventually dies very young. The circumcised and her holy sage, Krishna Dwaipayan, that is Vedavyas, actually begot me in the field of the pleasure-minded king. Despite my generation from him, my mind is brought low by addiction to hunting and gambling. I am an evil fellow, abandoned by gods. Here, he is critiquing this whole issue, apparently. The fact that he acknowledges that, look, I've been born of Vedavyas, but I have followed the tradition of my legal father. Here we see that Pandu's dialectics over the issue of identity is little painful to him. He was
torn by two paternal strains that he inherited. He was caught in the complexities of identity as he was a Kshetraj. Kshetraj is one who's born out of a niyog arrangement. And he acknowledged that he inherited the licentious nature of his legitimate father. Vichitraveer is the legitimate father. He's the Kshatriya. He's a Kshatriya. And yet, interestingly, the mythographers are very smart in this case. The act of acknowledgement or the sense of guilt is something that they say brings him. He's acknowledging the fact that he is lustful. He was lustful at one point in time, and that there is a sense of guilt that he has, and this brings him closer to the Brahminical trait of his biological father. Because somehow the way in the text it is always shown that truth is something which only a Brahmin has the guts to speak, and others than the Kshatriyas would always use it to their own end. So the issue of identity comes through, and by reading this passage, we can see that kind of dialectics. Now, that was one aspect I took into account. And again, here I'm only talking to you about the pedagogy of doing. I'm not really writing a paper. The second aspect that I take into account is association with beauty and divinity. Now, this idea of identity was intertwined with beauty and associated with also divinity. Pandavas, we know, are all semi-divine beings. With the use of mantra given by Durvasa Muni to Kunti, and later also Madri made use of it, they could just invoke divine beings and the queens could reproduce. So in a sense, all the Pandavas are semi-divine. Otherwise also within the text at different points, like in the Vanaparva, he's supposed to go and get those astras from a particular place in the mountains, and he encounters the mountain man, Shiva. Shiva is there, not as Shiva as we understand, like a mountain man. And then he has to remove a board and he fights. He keeps on fighting with Shiva, none other than Shiva. But then in a sense, he loses this, but the doors of heaven open up for him. Otherwise, also, Pandav's association with Krishna lend them superior status in the eyes of the readers and listeners of the tales. In terms of looks, I think we are told within the Mahabharata, Nakul is the most handsome of all Pandavas. But at the same time, Arjun was also desired by women. He attracted many women. We know the Manipur princess Chitrangada or the Naga princess Ulupi had relations with him, apart from Subhadra, who was Krishna's sister, and of course Draupadi. Draupadi was always drawn towards him, and she was supposed to be the most, out of all the Pandav husbands that she had, she thought she was closest to Arjun. Okay, so that's one aspect that we're taking at the beauty and the divinity. But a very essential ingredient of kingship was definitely virility. Virility and its symbolic correlates are highly charged and contested in the Mahabharata, and they permeate dharma and constitute one of the pervasive of preoccupations. In fact, the whole idea of virility gets reflected in the language of the day. No phallus, was one of the worst things that which a man could impute to himself or to another, for this was the it was a possession of phallus upon which the manhood, especially that of the king, was predicated. And anybody, you know, if you had to give a gali, that is the cuss word, these are the words that you will be using for that person, is kingly, impotent, panda, or talking about tritiya prakriti. Is tarah ke shabdon ka istemal hota tha, jo virility ke saath related the. That means you can't, you are not virile. Virility is so, so important, not just for procreation. Of course, it is for important for procreation. But otherwise, interestingly, even, you know, it gets associated with your ability to be brave. Draupadi, on being humiliated by Kauravas, had accused her husbands of being castrates, she would say. Shishupal accuses Bhishma of living like a eunuch and suggests that his celibacy is a lie that you maintain either from stupidity or impotence. The term that he uses in the Sabha Parvan is Klibavad. Duryodhan also remarks in the same text, that is Sabha Parvan, that he would neither be a man nor not a woman, he should be man, not a woman. He explains womanhood, manhood, non-womanhood, non-manhood in great detail, and says that if he tolerated Pandav's good future, fortune. So basically, the whole idea, he calls them, openly calls them Cleaves. How could you, he says that, I have been humiliating your wife and you can't even pick up arms to retaliate. What kind of men you are. Bhim also attempts to incite his brother Yudhishthira to action by wondering aloud in Ban Parva, and he says that you are Dharma, he was Dharmaputra, and keep crying Dharma. You emaciate yourself with your vows, but is it possible, O king, that despair has prompted you to a life of a eunuch? He's so angry with Yudhishthira because Yudhishthira would bring in the dilemma of Dharma every time he has to resort to violence, and Bhim is the one who's always ready to retaliate. And so he's just trying to say, do you not have enough guts? You don't have balls. That is the way one would understand it in today's language. But this is something, interestingly, this is being put across even earlier. So once again, we get the hint that king had to be gauged in terms of virility, of course, his procreative powers. Even when there is actually a reference of being veer, brave, those who are not veer are eunuchs. It's a little difference. Veer and veerya, the term which is used for seamen, and it has come from the same term as the etymology from the word veer. So there is a commonality between the two, and you see that kind of a linkage within the text. Valor and violence is also celebrated, very much celebrated. The text celebrates heroism. I've already given you example of one part where Arjun, despite the fact he's actually fighting out with Shiva, carries on his fight, and that is more important. Go and fight. Fight is what is important. He loses, but then he is sent to heaven. Doors of heaven get opened to him. Now, within the text, we have female voices that reiterate the need for the king and the kshatriyas to be very brave and to pick up arms to defend Draupadi. Now, Kunti actually tells us the story of Vidula when the sons come and want to take a blessing for before they go off. Vidula, once upon a time, she says, there was this queen mother Vidula whose son Sanjay was also a king, felt very dejected after he was defeated by the king of Sindhu, and he returned home. Now, this is something which Vidula is not able to accept. What does she say? She says, she's so angry to see a defeated son coming back. If the people do not speak of man's act as miracles, is merely another addition to the pile of humanity. He is neither a man nor a woman. A kshatriya, especially a king who clings to life without displaying to the highest degree possible his talents, then he is nothing less than a thief. A man who lives grandly by the strength of his arms obtains fame in this world and the good goal in the next. Further, she admonishes the son that he says, a forgiving man, a meek man is neither a man nor a woman. Remember, these are the qualities that would get associated with Yudhishthira. And that standing tall and keeping the effort on, Udyam, Jari Rakho, in the battlefield especially, that is Parusham, you should have Parush, Parush Hona Chahiye, That is what is going to help you gain victory. Similarly, Draupadi too reminds her husbands to act like men and fight off offenders. In one parva, Draupadi asked a very pertinent question to Yudhishthir, and Yudhishthir is always talking about dharma, that even if they were right, if they did the right thing, why is it that Duryodhan and Kaurava stood to gain? She recalled what had happened with her in Sabha Parvan and once again rebuked Yudhishthir for not following the Kshatriya dharma of a king. She lamented the condition in which Pandavas found themselves in forest and finally berated Yudhishthir for not applying his tejas, his power. And she says, why are you converting everything into kshama? Running throughout the argument, and this is something which is interesting, it's many years later, she doesn't forget that she was humiliated. Many years later, she asks him, why did you not become furious? The term that she is using is manyu. Kyun nahi istamal kiya? Manyu ka matlab hota hai frenzied anger. And she says, why not to that? Why did you just forgive those people? Why did you not pick up the arms? And she reminded Yudhishthir that there was no warrior or king who does not get angry when provoked. Finally sums it up by saying, generally, Yudhishthir, if a man acts, his attempts work out, while the lazy man nowhere finds things to succeed completely. So she is taunting him. She's taunting him and saying, like, why can't you be the one to take up violent when the need be. Another issue that comes associated with violence is the use of brute force at the time when you have to consolidate your treasury. Within the Apada Dharma Parva of the Mahabharata, Yudhishthir asks this question to Bhishma because he does not want to go into violence, and he says, do I need to resort to violence? That's when Bhishma says that king must establish his own well-being to secure the foundation of the kingdom, dharma, and this he can do by any means. Sarvopaya, that means kisi bhi means se tum kar sakte ho, the rivers of wealth should keep on flowing, and that is how the king is going to protect his kingdom. The king is advised that all aspects of society depend on kosha, the treasury and the army are the foundation of the king, and a depleted treasury is a clear sign of financial emergency. So he says that if need be, you must resort to violence. In other words, aggression, often bordering on unleashing of brute force, was acceptable for larger good. Sometimes the violence could be in form of verbal and non-verbal methods also. It does not always have to be in form of an action. So we are talking about humiliation. We're talking about insulting people in a very different way. We know that Draupadi was put to stake by her husband in the game of dice and was lost by Kauravas. Dushasan humiliated her by dragging her to the court at a time when she was menstruating and she was supposed to be in different quarters. She remained violently. She's the one who's so angry that her husbands did not intervene. Kauravas tried to disrobe her. She did not get disrobed. We know for different reasons. But the fact remains that they sought to boost their own ego and manliness by acquiring the property of Pandavas and humiliating them. Women often became the target by which opponents, that is men, were humiliated. It sounds very familiar. It happens till this date. You know that. Whenever you have to, the two groups are fighting amongst each other and you have to humiliate the other person, the way you target is rape of their women. And this is a very common thing. I mean, you can find examples in the Mahabharata and you can relate it to today's day also. Now, having looked at the association of king and violence, I have yet another way of looking at it. So, friends, what I'm doing is I'm looking at the whole issue from different vantages. So, was violence ever contested by a king? We are bringing in the issue of ethics versus violence, and it is a very fair, complex issue, especially if we think within the format of kingship. The non-espousal of blatant violence had put Yudhishthir in a very difficult position, especially as he was already, already assumed kingship. He was berated by his wife, his brothers for keeping off from shedding blood. In fact, he was convinced by Krishna and other Pandav brothers to speak half-truth about death of Ashwatthama in order to waylay Drona, the mightiest of the warriors. And we know that Yudhishthir's half-lie made Drona so distraught that he stopped fighting and he fell prey to Drishtadyumna's arrows. This made Yudhishthir feel extremely guilty. In fact, in the Brahminical scheme of a brave, fearless king, we find Yudhishthir had always fallen short of the ideal. Violence was regarded as a natural trait of a king, and Yudhishthira's quest against it was seemingly out of place. So he finally decides to quit, just renounce, not become the ruler, especially after seeing so much of bloodshed in war. Draupadi, along with Pandav, sought to dissuade the eldest brother from renouncing and put to him exhaustive arguments that this is something that you have actually won very, very, in a very legitimate way. Why do you want to give up on it? And especially we find Arjun, he's mocking at Yudhishthira and inquires of him, how could he abandon the earth which he has won in accord with what is called the Swadharma, that is dharma of Swadharma is the dharma of Kshatriya. And he's laughing at him and says, you think you can become a Brahmin and you think that you can renounce everything? You become a poor man and you lead us also to poverty. And for Arjun, like for Bhima also, asceticism was the same as poverty, and dharma and art could not be obtained in absence of wealth. So for a very long time, poor Yudhishthira has been berated in first chapter, second chapter, third chapter, he keeps on end. But by the time we reach the 12th chapter, he comes out with a very ferocious response. He speaks to Arjun. He says, if you do not thoroughly understand dharma, you should not criticize me in this way. Since I understand subtle meaning, sukshma dharma, of learned treatises and I'm skilled by the decisions concerning dharma. Among those who know the rules of battle, Arjun, you are the best. Dhananjay, you are the best. But don't try to teach me what is sukshma dharma. I will not accept the throne. It is so much, it has led to so much of bloodshed. Now, from the point of view of a history student, why should this kind of a myth come apart this is Anushasan Parv. Anushasan Parv is a text that came around roughly the same time when you also have, it's the post-Mauryan time, and also the time when Buddhism and Jainism have become very popular. You already have example of Ashok, the ruler, who could manage to carry on with Dhamma Vijaya, without, you know, renouncing violence and still holding up a huge empire. I think that is the kind of pressure that was being exercised on the mythographers of the day, and they tried to make peace with the situation in through the character of Yudhishthira. So Shanti Parva of Mahabharata gives us a peep into the process of refining the notion of ideal kingship. Yudhishthira has contested the use of violence, Bhishma, Krishna, Ved Vyas attempt to convince him to ascend the throne. So a compromise formula is worked out that violence would be used only in last resort, only for defense, not for fundamental, it will not be considered a fundamental constituent of kingship. So the passages that you have within the Shanti Parv between 92 to 98 discuss limitations and qualifications of king's use of physical force. And this is very interesting. It's Bhishma who says, meaning the moment you say Bhishma is talking about it, seems to have been coming from a holy antiquity. So Bhishma says, Yudhishthira, after assembling a vast army, you should first exert yourself to reverse things by means of conciliation, and only then exert in warfare. The worst kind of victory is the one which involves warfare. So what we find is there is a sense of remorse, an acknowledgement of the great war, the fact that everything gets destroyed. There is a sense of remorse, and also wondering, yes, we need to change our views on violence, on kingship. It has to be super refined. So Mahabharata then as a text takes us through a journey of changing notions of the ideal king. Issues of identity, which are founded on genealogy, beauty, association with divinity, stand out as important. But what were equally relevant were the notions of virility and valor. Now what happens through these 18 parvas is that some of the ideas remain relevant throughout the text and some start getting mutated. While virility, for example, remains relevant, kings do not hesitate to use services of those who would not be so virile. Shikhandi is the case in point. He is used to bring about the eventual death of Bhishma, not eventual death, but obviously getting him out of the battlefield. Finally, coming to so what we have similarly, the blatant use of violence was eventually replaced by a more principled use, and a kind of a discussion in this direction starts from the 11th parva itself, the Stri parva, the sense of remorse that comes, Shanti parva, Anushasan parva. They gradually come into the point, no, there can only be principled use of violence, and violence should not be the essential constituent of kingship, and that's a far cry from what we understand in the beginning, you know, of the Mahabharata. Finally, coming to the last point with which I started, was the king sane as the state? Now, the text clearly warns us against it. Repeatedly, the wise counsel of ministers and especially Brahmins are considered to be very, very essential, advised in that direction. And we are told by the example, through the example of Duryodhan, that he did not take the wise counsel of elders around him, of the ministers, except for his mama, Shakuni. He's not really paying attention to his mother, father, Vidura and others, Bhishma. And what happens to him? We all know what the state was. So the king is not supposed to be exactly like the state. No, there's a difference. Though if you were to look at Ashoka's inscriptions, and in a moment, I think Shatrupa is going to talk about that. If you were to look at Ashoka's inscription, he is the state. Wo apne aap ko state hi batata hai. Everything, he is everything. But if you were to look at the text, the king is warned time and again, you are not the state, you are an executioner within the state. So executioner of the policies that we all make in a collective way. You may be at the top, but you have to use the wise counsel of other people. But all this you will get to know when you do a very careful study of the text, if you choose to do that. But so much about the ideal king from the perspective of a text. Now I hand over to Shatrupa. She'll tell you how the ideal king, the image is created from the perspective of epigraphs. Thank you.
Thank you. Should I continue or?
Yeah, please continue. Why don't you share your PPT?
I will share my PPT. So thank you to the organizers. Thank you to Uttara. Thank you to Smita for laying this background because hello? Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. You're audible.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. So that background, that beginning is definitely very important. So I'll share my screen. I hope you all can see my screen. So you have started looking at this question of research methodology, and you looked into and talked. Got to know about, you have talks about how to frame a question, how to start the journey, and it had become very important to understand how do we do research. Now in this session, sources is what we talked about. You just learned and talked, we, Smita, discussed a lot about the text, and also texts like Mahabharata, and what does a text like Mahabharata can tell us. So we thought that instead of just rambling about the source, it would be a good idea to actually present a question and then show you how different sources are going to deal with this question. So how different sources would deal with the same question differently. So, but before I start with it, this talk will be divided into two parts. First is I will speak about epigraphs, introduce you to epigraphs, introduce you to all the works based on epigraphs, and then I will deal with this question of who is an ideal king. But one has to remember, the inscriptions are not going to tell us that this is an ideal king. They just are describing in their genealogy. So one has to see what is the recurrent theme that is coming up. What features are so important that they are mentioned. So that is what we will start with, but let me first start with epigraphs. So what are epigraphs and how they are different from other sources? Epigraphs are a representation of the period, of the time, of the region that we are looking into. It gives us a peep into the minds of the donor. It could be the king, it could be someone else, one who is engraving it, who is writing it, who the king is, who the queen is. So there are so many different people who are associated with an epigraph. So it gives us an idea, a hint about these people and what they were thinking about it, why they are giving an epigraph, why they are recording it, what makes them recording a certain material, what language they are using. So there are many things that we therefore has to understand. For example, as Ashoka's point was raised just now by Smita, that how Ashoka commands in his inscription, the kind of voice, the kind of agency that he uses is not found in any other inscription. We don't find any other inscription which is speaking like Ashoka speaks. So that's a very different genre of inscription. Similarly, the kind of details that you find from the Gupta times, that becomes much more elaborate and eulogistic by the early medieval times. And as we move on to regions, different regions will have their different way of looking into or writing an epigraph or writing a record, and why they record, what they record, that would be completely different. So epigraphs are something that was used, that would have actually, if I put it in a very simple way, that it could have made sense at that time. So that is what they are doing when they are writing an epigraph. It has to make sense to the people then and there. It's like a sculpture. A sculpture that you see, say, in any of the temple or any of the huge temples, early temples, whichever period that you're looking into, that is what people should be able to understand and appreciate. They are not going to make something out of the world in a temple, because people will not be able to relate to it. So that is one very important perspective about epigraph, that they are representing the period. They are to be read, to be seen during, in that region, during that period. So it has to make that sense, and that is the reason epigraphs are very different from other sources. And one can see the transformation changes when one compares inscription within that period, across different regions, across different periods. One can see the transitions, changes that are happening. And the changes, to recognize the changes, we would need a textual source to see the changes and correlate them with the textual sources. So that's why sources, different sources have to be brought together. Then only you can understand the period. Then only you can actually enjoy the period. Daudali calls inscriptions as kavyas. He says they are as structured, as beautifully ornated as a kavya. And he says that it can tell us a lot about the country, the culture, about society that it represents. So the inscriptions, it gives us date, the geographical location, like especially if it's a temple inscription, if it's on a sculpture, it gives us revenue detail, administrative detail, religious traditions, cults, information about so much can be gleaned from the inscription. And these inscriptions, as we know, these are not prescriptive, these are not normative. So inscriptions are not going to tell us what is good, what is ideal. They are showing us what they think is what they, because what they want to show more is what they are practicing. Although there is a path where we can talk about whether it's true or not, whether the what they are claiming to have done, did they really do it? So one can check from other epigraphs, other sources, to see whether that episode actually, or that event actually happened or not. So definitely, as with all other sources, inscriptions also have their problems. And one of the problem is that it lacks objectivity. So inscriptions are not objective. They are not going to tell you the truth. They're not telling you, you have to cross-check. You have to take what they say with a pinch of salt. You have to compare. You have to be very cautious of how you're using. And therefore, for a very long time, when we look at, when we talk about sources, most scholars would prefer archaeology or textual sources as an important basis. Epigraphs were kind of sidelined, because epigraphs were seen to be just giving only genealogical details. Now scholars are using epigraphs in a much better way when they are trying to, using it in a way when one can understand the region, understand people. Definitely, as you will understand that, you know, the inscriptions are interpolated. There are also cases of fake inscriptions, specifically in case of copper plate grants, etc. There are many names, terms used are, we don't know the meaning of those terms which are there many a times. Places which are mentioned cannot be identified. Thus, the information that the inscription gives us is also incomplete. Besides, there are also many different strata of society about whom inscriptions tell us nothing. We must remember, when we are looking at an epigraph, we are actually, the details that we are getting from the inscription is about the elites, about people who have resources and who can give that as donation. So we are not talking about people who have nothing to give. although like when we talk about, you know, Buddhist and Jain inscriptions or, you know, such smaller donative inscriptions, they also can give us a more about people who are not so resourceful. But the land grant inscription that we have, which is mostly descriptive and elaborative, which tells us a lot about the society and period, will definitely be given either by the king or the queen, the minister, the feudatories, and so on. So it is kind of tells us the story of, say, the people who are resourceful, not for everyone. So it is, there are so many people about whom we can never know if you're only looking at inscription. So there's definitely a problem here. Another thing which Richard Salomon talks about, and which is very important for us to remember, that these are not historical documents. And Richard Salomon says that these are, they're generally inscriptions, the epigraphs or panegyric, which incidentally records some historical information. So the purpose of the inscription is not to record history. So they don't intend, they are incidentally recording historical events, incidentally mentioning certain things, but their attempt is not to write an historical document. And so one cannot construct the dynastic chart, and because it's not a king's list that we, and Richard Salomon uses a very interesting term, that this is, inscriptions suffer from what he calls collateral oppression. That is, it only mentions the successor king. And in the process, there are many who are omitted or suppressed. A very good example of this can be, if you think of daughters, you hardly get to know about any daughter in from the inscription. Very few daughters are mentioned. So are we saying that the kings never had any daughter? But we know that there were matrimonial relationships. We get to know that the matrimonial political marriages were very important, and that we see in case of many dynasties, and how the fortune of the king changes after that matrimonial relationship is also noticed in many inscriptions. So if marriage is important, that relationship is important, that alliance is important, but daughters are never there, because inscriptions have a very clear-cut aim, that is to record only the successor, and that is the son, whichever son who claims power is the one who is going to be mentioned, because he is the one who is actually getting the inscription recorded. So besides, definitely the collateral branches are missed out. If there's overstepping of a dynastic chart, dynastic, you know, succession in dynastic succession, then those kings are, you know, deleted. If there's a coup, there is a deletion of or omission of people. So it is not a comprehensive list. Inscriptions are never giving us a comprehensive list. So therefore, we cannot reconstruct the dynastic chart. We can't reconstruct the line, the number of kings, family chart. It's not a family tree. It's not a family chart that we get. It is only the list of successors. So one has to be, again, keep this in mind when we're using inscriptions, even if we are using them as a genealogical purpose. What I'm showing you next here is what you can see I just mentioned, this is a very minuscule representation of what different kinds of inscriptions can be there. So I want to highlight this, that how they are different. First, starting on the left is the first image, is a pot which has an inscription. You can't see it very clearly, but there are some very small inscription which is written on it. Then is the Ashokan pillar edict. I'm sure many of you would have recognized it well. Then again is an Ashokan rock edict. Again, very clear. Bottom left is the Nanaghat inscription, a cave inscription of Naganika, the Satvahan queen. Then is the Hathigumpa inscription of King Kharavela. Then you can see next is the Allahabad pillar inscription. And the last is the Ajanta cave inscription of the Vakataka time. This was given by Hari Singh, because Vakatakas otherwise claim to be a worshipper of Bhairav. They are talking about being a worshipper of Shiva. They don't give mention being donating much to the Buddhist sect. But Hari Singh, who was a minister, gave two inscriptions in Ajanta, in Ajanta caves. The next one, as again from the left, you can see is a Kanheri rock inscription. This is a Buddhist inscription of 1st century we see the next middle one are the copper plate inscription. The idea is to give you an hint of what a copper plate inscription with a seal would look like. The bottom one in the middle section is the Banskera inscription of Hush. The last picture that you can see is the Ajaygarh fort inscription. This is Ajaygarh fort, which was under the Chandelas. They built this fort, and this is an inscription that is inscribed there. So what you can make out here is that there can be so many kinds of inscription. What one has to keep in mind is that the objective and purpose to record them are very different. Some are recording donations, some are panegyric, some are official orders. To add to this list, you can think of the inscriptions below a statue, near a well. There are so many kinds of inscriptions. So we can't put inscriptions or epigraphs in one block and say, okay, this is a source and this is what we are going to use. You cannot. And you have to choose. If you're choosing or thinking about understanding certain aspect of history from epigraphs, you have to think, what inscription will you choose? Which record, which period, which region will you choose? Because you cannot get everything from one inscription or one set of inscription. You have to choose which genre of inscription that you wish to look at. And that is very relevant. So depending on the genre that you choose, you need to look at the time, the period, the context, the region. These are very, very important, very relevant for the inscription. You can start without understanding this as a background. Now, so what next, what I talk about is what can inscription tell us? Salomon gives us a detailed discussion on the material and the types of inscription, the techniques of writing, material preparation, technicalities of writing, and so on. The what different kinds of inscriptions can be there, as we just talked about, something like the official voice, like Ashoka's. Then the gift giving, like most or 80%, if not more, or 80 or 75 to 80% of inscriptions that we find, which have been published, are all gift donations. They talk about a donating gift. So most of the inscriptions are about donations. Prashasti, which is eulogy, like the Gupta, the Allahabad pillar inscription is a very good example. It gives us a prashasti. It talks about a lot about someone's book. It gives us genealogical details. So it tells us who came, which ruler, who's born of who, which king. So all that genealogical details are there. There can be donative, like the Buddhist or the Jain ones. There are also Sati stones and the Hero stones, which also are very interesting because they also talk about the conflicts that are there. Because we find many Sati stones specifically for the Chandelas, who were to talk about because this is a time when the Hunas were coming in. So there are inscriptions which are the Sati stone inscriptions. So there is it shows the evidence. It's an evidence one can see it in terms of the violence and the war and the impact of war that can be seen. So a great variety of inscriptions are found from the modern times to the medieval and also to the modern times. So I'm not looking into the modern and the medieval inscriptions, but definitely there will be a set pattern and one can really use them at the same time for understanding that period. Another thing that one has to keep in mind is the functional and the practical aspect of the inscription as opposed to the non-functional part. So when I have been given a grant or I am giving a grant, obviously what is important is the grant. What is being given, maybe the village or the whatever aspect of whatever tax exemption has been given, that is the functional aspect. What is non-functional is the king's genealogy. If supposedly a grant is given by a minister, the minister is supposed to mention the genealogy of the king. So genealogy is going to become part of the non-functional part of the non-functional aspect of the inscription, whereas what is being given as the grant, the tax exemption, villages or whatever has been done and whatever purposefully they record is what becomes the functional aspect. So therefore these also has to be kept in mind. Now so inscriptions are of different kinds, different varieties, and first and foremost, what we can see or what we can get is the language and the script used. These are very important issues because what language is used, and from Ashokan inscription, I'm not going to talk about them, but you know how language and the script changes And that is seen as a very important characteristic of these inscriptions. And that has also led to question. Kind of seen as a, also as can be seen as a dent on his power and authority. At the same time, it can also be an idea of how he wants it to be read and understood. So the purpose and the objective of the inscription has also to be kept in mind. So language could be Sanskrit, Pali, Prakrit, the vernaculars, which could be used as official languages. Sometimes, you know, what is interesting is the functional part of the record here, whereas the non-functional part is in Sanskrit. So very clearly, they knew that no one is going to read, or what people would like to know and understand is the functional, what the grant has been given. For example, the Basim plates of Vindhya Shakti of the Vatsagulma branch, this is a branch of the Vakataka dynasty. In that part of the, where they mention the grant is in Prakrit, whereas the genealogical part is in Sanskrit. Although later on, like then the Gupta, then later on, the entire grant becomes in, comes in Sanskrit. By the time we are moving to more regional regions, more towards the end of the early medieval, touching medieval, we find and come use of vernacular becoming very important. Maharashtri, Magadhi, Prakrit, Bengali, Oriya, all these words are coming into inscription because, and mostly they come into the functional part of the inscription because that is what is what people would like to read and know about. So that is another thing that is very interesting. The Junagadh inscription was one of the first Junagadh inscription of Rudradaman. Was one of the first long epigraph in classical language and style. What is also very important is a fine spot. Where do you find that inscription? So whether it's on a temple, whether it's near a well, whether it's in a cave, whether it's a copper plate, because what you write, how you write, by your writing, your objective, your purpose can be understood by looking at where the inscription was placed. So if you're putting it on a wall, on a temple, it's different. If you're putting on a pillar, it's different. If the pillar is outside a temple, if the pillar is inside a fort, so all these should also can also make has would have an impact, and one has to keep this in mind as well. The script, if we talk about like Brahmi, Kharoshti, Nagri, there is a Kutila variety. There is every region. Which will tell us the technicalities, how difficult it is to inscribe a stone, how difficult it is to inscribe on a small copper plate and write lines and lines. It's a very technical, difficult task that we are looking at. Place I talked about, that the place of the inscription is also very important. Purpose, what is the purpose of the inscription? One that is mentioned here, and one which is not mentioned. Most many inscriptions very clearly mention that the purpose of this grant is welfare of all. It is for my religious merit. It is for my parents' benefit. It is for my mother's benefit. It is, so they mention that this is for punya. This is one of the reason why I'm getting the record, why I'm giving this donation is punya. Although that is only one way. That's what is in head, what is out there on the inscription, but there's also another ways in which one can look at the purpose of an inscription. It tells us about the connections which are sought or claimed. Patronage to a certain cult or religious tradition. For example, the Shaiva cult such as the Pashupatas are mentioned in the Kalachuri inscriptions. For example, the Bilhari grant of Yuvraj Dev mentions the coming of the Pashupatas. They mention the entire genealogy of the sect. So that is Guru Shishya. That's how they are mentioned. That's how the genealogy would work. So the entire genealogy is mentioned. And they in many of their grants, the Kalachuris mentioned the Pashupatas. So that is seen as a coming of this particular sect in this particular region. So the traditions, the like religious traditions can be seen. Buddhist traditions, for example, Vakatakas, we talked about the Vakatakas just now, that how one minister would be would grant to the Ajanta caves, to the Buddhist caves, whereas the kings were Shaivites. Another thing that we definitely get to know is the power linkages. For example, who are granting? Who is granting? Whether the king is giving, queen is giving, whether the king, queen, minister, trader, merchants, all are giving to, whether it's a joint donation, because that is going to tell us that the interlinkages that they are sorting out. For example, there's a very interesting Chandela grant, which is called the calendar plates at the time of Madan Varman. It grants a records a grant of Mahanachini Padmavati and Mahapratihar Sangram Singh. These two people, so one is a Mahanachini, one is a dancer, other is an officer, Mahapratihar. They together are giving a recording a donation. It's a little lost. It had due to weathering, it is not there. You can't read the entire inscription clearly, but it mentions these two people very clearly. So one can see, one can imagine the kind of interlinkages that they are sorting, the kind of connections that they are looking at. And this particular inscription is within the fort. It's on a pillar on the fort. So again, it's there in the fort. And the connection that they are trying to forge here, the connection in the linkages that they are talking about. Besides, we obviously get to know about various people mentioned, like the administrative and the social, the donor, donees, the officers associated with the revenue department, the administrative details, and temple statues. There are so much that one can get to know from the inscription, depending on what we are looking at. We also get to know definitely about the revenue detail. For example, the taxation, what is exempted, what land is being given, how the land is being described, the boundaries described, how they describe the boundaries. If they got land donation, how are they measuring that land is also different from period to period, region to region. All these details can be gleaned that could be more taken out from the inscription. We also get to know about the dating pattern, how do they date themselves, whether they use regnal years, whether they use dynastic eras, whether they use longer tradition like Vikram Samvat. Besides, they also sometimes mention the season, months, phases of moon, certain rites, certain rituals, certain vrat that they've had, whether it's a full moon or it's Amavasya. They mention everything. So there are many, many such details. And that also leads to a lot of questions about, for example, if you use only regnal year, many scholars would hold that, you know, you are actually not so powerful because you are not thinking about beyond your smaller region. But that can be big, that can be a big question, because we know Ashoka, who was a very powerful ruler, was using regnal year. But, and so, although that is seen as one way to understand the power and authority of a king, but that's not the last word on it, because there has to be other ways in which one understands the power. And of course, the last thing is the grant, what they are granting, so what they have access to, whether the mostly as many a times what we see, the village, the king is granting the village, whereas when it comes to ministers and feudatories, they are giving a well or a garden or so on. So many a times we see that kind of change in terms of who is giving to what. So king is mostly giving bigger, larger villages, more lands than others. Now, I'll quickly move on to people who have worked on epigraphs. Many scholars have utilized inscription, and you know, sometimes you cannot talk about a period without inscription. For example, I'm sure many of you have read Narendrajot Lahiri's work on Ashoka, and it is using inscription, textual sources, architecture, archaeology, so much it is using together to build on Ashoka. So it's a very interesting work. So definitely you cannot write a paper on Ashoka without looking at his history. You cannot just do it. Similarly, Guptas, you can't look at Guptas without looking at inscriptions. And also coins. Guptas had beautiful coins. So epigraphs become a very important tool for us. Even Arish Sharma, when he talks about Indian feudalism, he is using inscriptions. Although his idea of using, the idea behind his using inscription is to understand feudalism in Indian context. And many people have used the same way, used inscription to negate or support feudalism. So B.D. Chattopadhyay, Mahesh Sharma, Nandini Sinha Kapoor, and many others have worked using inscription to understand the taxation, to understand the administrative detail, how large the state is, how complex the state is. Even Kim Shimali's work is a very good work on the Vakataka inscription. And there are many inscriptions which are otherwise not available. One can be seen in this book on agrarian crisis, which he talks about. He is also building it around the feudal debate, and he's using inscription to talk about. Cynthia Talbot, I'm sure many of you would have actually read her work, The Pre-Colonial India in Practice. It is about inscription. Her focus has been on Kakatiya dynasty, and he looks beyond them as well, builds on the history, uses a very critical, nuanced way to understand inscription. She also talks about how inscription has to be seen in its entirety, how it can be useful and as a source, and how important it can be as a source, but it has to be seen, at together. You can't just pick up one inscription and that's all. That cannot tell you about the dynasty. That cannot tell you about that region. Lekhior also had a very interesting work, which is Donors, Devotees and Daughters of God. It's on inscriptional record in Tamil Nadu, and it talks about Tevarathiyal, that is the temple women. She looks into the temple men and women and looks at religious donation, privileges, gifting, social connections drawn. And it's also, these are interesting work which changed the entire way in which inscriptions or epigraphs have been used for a historical study. Both her work, again, mostly it's a work which is using gender as well as inscription. Both her work, The Invisible Woman and The Run, which is, she has written very recently, that is Obscurity, From Obscurity to Light, uses inscription to understand the region from a gender perspective. The latest work is on Orissa, and she traces the entire history of, not the entire history, but the early medieval times of Orissa by looking at inscriptions. It's a very good work. Kirisha has also looked in inscriptions and gender, and he has done works on the Chandela Grant, where he talked about the Chandela Grant given by two queens. Besides, there are many histories which have been built, like BKR has done on Orissa. Hans Baker has worked on Vakatakas. He uses sculptures as well as inscriptions. A.M. Shastri again has a very good work on inscriptions. R.K. Sharma has looked into the Kalachuri times. Upinder Singh has worked on Orissa. The Brahmins and the Kings and the Brahmins is a very interesting book on which is based, again, based on inscription. Many other works which are utilized in specifically for tracing the political, cultural, and religious history of a region. The next question that I'm going to talk about is, who is an ideal king? And do inscription tell us who is ideal? So are inscription telling us that this is, or they are hinting us that this is what they think is ideal, and which can also change? So what the inscription mentioned tells us is that what it thinks or what it considers, who they consider as their noteworthy ancestors, and what are the qualities that they think are worth mentioning. So what is interesting is what they omit and what they write, how they talk about their genealogy, how they mention about the earlier rulers, what they think are the qualities of that. And that is how we are going to build on the ideal of king. So for when I'm looking at using inscription, I have to depend on a textual source. So I would definitely draw upon, say, the Mahabharata or the Arthashastra or other such texts to understand what is the ideal. Because then only I can understand whether what inscriptions are telling me is the ideal king or not. Or how are they borrowing? So the connection between the two sources. Because remember, when these people, these kings, if I'm looking at the kings only, if these kings are writing an epigraph, recording their donation, they are within a context. They're also probably reading these texts. They're also aware of these texts. They're aware of these stories, these epics. They're aware of the Puranas. They're aware of these various, these normative and prescriptive texts. So they are, that is the background from where they are building it. So it's very interesting to look at this question of who is a king, what qualities and does it have, and see whether how much are they borrowing from these texts which are there. So how their ideals are being actually formulated. That is what inscription can tell us. Whether we think these are ideals or not is something that we are judging, because we are also objective about reading the inscription. But definitely, the inscription can definitely tell us what they worth mentioning, and then think whether it's an ideal or not, and whether they are following a Dharmashastric norm or whether they are following a Puranic norm, what text they would have been utilizing, all this would be later. The region and the period is definitely very important, as ideals would change over time. For example, performing sacrifices are mentioned in the Gupta Dhammatakas, but by the later period, such references are not found at all. And it's because these performing sacrifices are not important. They don't want to connect to those things. They don't think that these are something which are relevant, which have to be mentioned on an epigraph. So they change from there. So rather they would have mentioned other qualities rather than talking about the king's performing sacrifices. Other thing which is another very interesting, which, and you will see that how both our sources, both Smita ma'am's source, that is Mahabharata, and inscription that I'm going to look at, are talking about the very similar things, but from a very, they're changing the lens through which they are talking about this issue. So claim to divinity is also there, and what we see change here is that from being divine, they are moving to semi-divine on Puranic characters. Over a period of time, as we look from the Gupta time to the early medieval times, we see that how they change. Till the Gupta times, the king being very similar to Indra or to these deities is very, to Som or to Agni is very, Rudra is very important. But by the time they're moving on, they are comparing themselves to Yudhishthir, they are comparing themselves to Arjun, they are calling themselves Vyas, they are calling themselves Kartavirya Arjun, they are calling themselves Yayati. They are using various other characters. So you just claiming this is not what they think is important now. No longer that is important, because these Purans, these other stories have come up, and they are the one which people can relate to. So inscriptions are also telling us this change that had happened, that change that one can. Another way to understand an ideal king is to look at the titles that they use. King like Ashok used nothing. He just called himself Devnam Piyadasi. He is not using any title, only very few inscription that he uses Raja Ashok. So you can imagine he is not using any title. He is not calling himself great so and so and so. He is just saying what he wants, what he thinks, what he likes, and that for him is enough as a marker for him to be identified and important enough to claim his authority. From there, we move on to simple titles like Maharaj, then to Maharajadhiraj. That is what we see in the Guptas. By the time we are moving to, say, the medieval times, early medieval times, we use what I have written here is are called PMP titles. That is Param Maharaja, Parameshwar Maharaja Dhiraj, Param Bhattarak Maharaja Dhiraj Parameshwar. So it's a huge title that they use. Besides that, they use many other ways to describe themselves, many other attributes they add. So they call themselves Narpati, Gajpati. They also use PMP, that is Param Bhattarak, Param Maheshwar, Parameshwar. Besides many such such titles that they use. And that is a complexity that we see in the ideal of a kingship. Besides, another very important ideal is giving to Brahmins, giving grants to Brahmins. And that is something that they talk about, that, you know, and they more or less, a good number, at least 50% of inscriptions, if not more, would be simply giving donations to Brahmins, because that is the way in which you legitimize your position. That is how the legitimization process would work. So from this stand where they mention only grants to Brahmins, these grants to secular, to move to secular grants. By the time of Chandela, we find grants given to ministers for their heroic deeds. So they talk about a grant has been given, some donations have been given, a village has been given to a minister because he saved the king from a crocodile attack. Then there are others because, if you remember, I just spoke about that the Chandelas, when they were there, they were the Hunas who were attacking them. There's a lot of mention of the heroic deeds and the way in which they laid down their lives for the country, for the region, for the king, and that's why they have been given grants. So the reasons of the grants are also seeing a transformation from the earlier times to the later times. That is another a very interesting change that one can see. What you can see here is what I've just tried to place some identities, identity markers of a king. And I have divided them into two, that is the implicit markers and the explicit markers. What are the implicit markers that I'm talking about? These are the markers like the language used, the script used, the dating method used. One can see change the terms, for example, the longer tradition or the regnal years or a strong state where they sometimes also use like the Vikram Samvat and so on. So what is the dating method that they use? Because there also we can think about an identity marker of a king in terms of the administrative tools he's using. Although although these would also become part of the administrative tools, but what can be, you know, segregated from this is the like the writers, the inscriber, the eulogist, all these officers who are being mentioned. So what are the officers that the kings aren't mentioning can be seen as an implicit marker. The explicit marker obviously are much more detailed. We can start with the titles. Titles claim, I'm very clearly, I'm specifying here that I'm talking about the titles claimed, because titles claimed can be very different from the titles which are ascribed to them. A king can call himself, you know, use Param Bhattarak Maharaja Dhiraj Parmeshwar, and their you know, successors, maybe 2-3 generations later, or even the next generation, might just call them Maharaj. So that means the king is claiming a higher title for himself, but not necessarily that he would have that kind of status in the dynasty. So there is a conflict, there is a contestation here that one can see. So, but when I'm talking about the identity marker of a king, I can definitely talk about the titles claimed and the titles ascribed. But right now I've just mentioned the titles claimed. Then how are they placed within the genealogical chart? Where are they placed? Whether they are omitted, whether they are not mentioned, whether they are just mentioned, or whether they are, you know, details about them are mentioned, that will tell us how important they are. So qualities, then the qualities mentioned, for example, being very brave, the rightful ruler, follower of law, very wise, beautiful, one who brings prosperity, who gives successors, wins over enemies, who is desirable, and in many cases, as also you saw in case of Mahabharata, and in case of text, being desired by women or have access to women. What is also interesting is, you know, many a times, as Sandhya Karanandin's Ram Charita, which is written for a Pala king, Ram book, it gives you this hint of why they use women as a trope, thereby you talk about how control over women is very important. Because Sandhya Karanin, when he talks about, when he writes, this is a poem that he wrote, in talking about Ram, and he's talking about Ram, and he's talking Sita. Here, Sita is not a woman, Sita is the land. So, and there are descriptions of how he's holding the hand of Sita, how he's pulling her. So there is a complete, you know, very, very descriptive of this relationship between the king and the land. And that relationship is on patriarchy. That is the way in which the qualities, and therefore one has to, therefore the, you know, when we get references to rivers of tears of enemies, women, all these are the ways in which the king identifies. So there are borrowings, these textual sources, these kavyas that use these kind of, besides obviously compassion can be one thing. Divine connections, I just mentioned, they are compared to deities, semi-divine, divine, Quranic characters, kings, like they are compared to Karna, they are compared to Yudhishthira, they are compared to Yayati, to Vyas, to Kartavirya, Arjun, there are n number of, they are compared to Dharma, son of Dharma, that is Yudhishthira again, son of Virochan, son of Indra. So there are various ways in which they use these texts. The next thing obviously is access to resources, what they can give, what they cannot, what they are giving. They are giving gifts to the Brahmins who are well versed. They mentioned the Gotra and Prabhara of the Brahmin. They mentioned what Vedas they are well versed with. So in a way, they are also kind of, one, they are giving the grant, definitely, but they are also giving that the Dhoni who is being granted is also very eligible. So they mention these various details about the Dhoni, that how they have found a very good Dhoni, a very good Brahmin. So it has to be a good Brahmin from a certain Gotra, who is well versed in a specific text, and that depends on which region and which period you are looking at. Besides for the tax exemptions, grant, village granted, test built, gardens built. So there are many, many such kind of resources that they are tax, what they access, what they can give. The king can give you exemption from taxes, but when the others are giving other donation by elite, other elite men, they are, you know, they might be just giving you certain part of their wealth. So there is a difference in that aspect as well. Ritual power or the adherence to Dharma Shastra norm, very interestingly, as I show you in some of these case of these inscriptions as well, the Dharma Shastra norm that they talk about, how the king is described as one who removed Kali, who established the four caste, who established the Varna Ashram, who made sure that people are following the law. So this adherence to Dharma Shastra is also something very interestingly comes up in the early medieval inscription. Another definitely a very clear marker is the seal, specifically that is for the copper plates. It's a kind of authentication of the authority of the ruler. So a ruler will definitely will be using a seal, and that should be there. So many a times when the seal is not present, that leads to a questioning of whether the grant is actually right or not, or whether it's a fake grant or not, whether it's an interpolated one or not. Next, I show you quickly, I don't think I have a lot of time, but let me quickly show you some inscriptions and which will tell you the whole idea what I've been describing. The identities that I've been talking about are, how are they mentioned in the inscription? I've here mentioned 2-3 inscriptions. I'm very consciously not using the Allahabad pillar inscription, because I'm sure first all of you might be very aware of it, and I want to show you how the genealogical pattern would work. So this is one of the many inscriptions that I'm looking at. This is the Iran stone inscription of Samud's book. This is found near a temple. The temple is no longer found, but it mentions, so there is a hint that this is a pillar which is near a temple, near Erikirana, Kina, this is Iran. The language used is Sanskrit and has a southern class of alphabets. I'm not going to into further details, because there will be a lot of details if one is looking at an inscription. So I'm quickly moving on to how the king identifies himself. So the verse 3 says that there was a king, Samudragupta, who was equal to the god Dhanat and Antaka in joy and wrath. These are translation by R.D. Banerjee. This is from Corpus Inscriptionum Indicarum, volume 3. So this is not my translation. This inscription is in Sanskrit. So this is a translation done by R.D. Banerjee. So I'm just showing it to you. Through his excellent knowledge and policy, and by whom the whole tribe of the king upon the earth was through their mere mandate set upon firm with their own sovereignty and wealth. The verse 4 says, who became a king of irresistible prowess, that is Indra on earth, being on earth the titles and glories of a king. So he's Samudra is actually, they are the, if you compare them to the later one, Guptas are the most simple inscriptions you can think of. They are not actually describing themselves. When we move on to the later early medieval inscription, there are paragraphs and paragraphs of description of a king. So this is actually a very simplistic description that they are making here, where they're talking about that he's honored with the titles and glories of a king, and he's consecrated by these princes. So this is definitely mentioning to the ritual when he's made. So whether it's a mention of the Vajaspaya or the Rajasuya Yagya, because it is talking about consecration by priest sprinkling, assuredly by his father. So he's a rightful heir. He's not usurping the throne. He's given this throne by his father. That's what it means here. Urged by supreme joy, being satisfied with his devotion, policy, and valor. So his father is very happy with his devotion, his policy, and his valor, and he is choosing him as a successor. And the next is very interesting. The goddess of wealth, that is Shri, that is fortune or Lakshmi, whose purchase price was provided by his manliness and the prowess. So here again, you can see the gendered lens of talking about him and how he controls wealth. And that control history in terms of a man's control over a woman. And by his manliness and prowess, who possessed by an abundance of elephant, horses, gems, money, and grains, who passed over to his many sons and grandsons. So again, here the concept of virility, of fertility, of providing successors, one who is, you know, successfully providing the heir to the throne. That is very important. Settled down in his family, being always contented as of good birth, observing the vow of chastity. Here, the description of Lakshmi fortune. He's talking about that how he passed on this fortune to his family, to his grandsons, and Lakshmi.
Wife of Chandragupta II, but Kubera Naga was not mentioned in the Gupta genealogy. Now, I just wanted to show you very quickly. I am not going to do this. It's a lot of details here, and I know we are running short of time. The color theories, very interestingly, what you can see, I'll just read the Bilhari stone inscription, which is a long description of kings. It starts with Kokala Deva. This is of the Tripuri branch. And it describes the Kokala Deva as a valorous king who was adorned with pride and had killed his enemies. Then Mugdha Tung was depicted as one who has destroyed his enemies, brave, and was known for good deeds. Then there's description of Keyur Varsh, which was very patriarchal. His most important qualification was that he had access to women of different countries. According to the inscription, he fulfilled the desires of women of Gaur, sported on the breast of the women of Karnat, applied ornamental marks on the forehead of the women of Lat, enjoyed the love of women of Kashmir, and found the songs of the women of Kaling. So this is a way in which he's describing exploits, not sexual exploits, not just sexual exploits, but also the political exploits that he had, how many lands he has won. So he's a great warrior, and these are his qualities. So similarly, what you see, for example, the Reva stone inscription of Karn mentions Karn as the lord of earth. He is depicted as a lion whose knees were the sacred law and legs are the Qurans. The depiction is very unique and is very similar to the Narsimha avatar of Vishnu. So you can see how they are using the same imagery. It's probably an attempt to revive the old tradition. And similarly, another very, very commonly used way to describe a king is of one who led the Kali Yuga, end of Kali Yuga, who brought shine to the dark ages, who was a wish fulfilling tree, who was desired by women, who was generous, liberal, great warrior, fortunate, lord of the world, famous. All these are qualities which become more important here. By the time they're coming to the 10th, 11th century, there is no reference to sacrifices. They are not even claiming that their ancestors did sacrifices. So they are just claiming these as remover of Kali. So these are clearly Puranic and Dharmashastric norms that they are trying to build in. They hear Purans and these comparison to these things, these semi-divine characters, these notions of Kali Yuga, notions of Krita Yuga is what is becoming more important here. So I conclude here when I talk about the king, who is a king, and I don't want to give a long conclusion because I'm sure you all are very tired by now. So what I can just end by saying two things is that first, the changing, when we look at epigraphs, one has to see this changing notion of kingship that becomes very visible. Besides what they are claiming, what they are ascribing, another very important important point is that you can't just pick one inscription and that's all. You have to look at the inscriptions of the region or the dynasty together, and its entirety that becomes so important for them. And very importantly, again, is the borrowing from these normative texts that you can see as very clear. There were also, one can question about the identities claimed by the queens. That's a very different and totally different study altogether. One need to compare it with other sources besides the textual sources, without which you cannot do. You need to look at sculptures, coins, and many things. So quickly, that's where I will end here. And so Smita can come in now. And if you have questions, then we can talk about it. I'm sorry it took so long.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you again, Smita ma'am and Shatrupa ma'am, for sharing your time with us and delivering this wonderful lecture. It was informative and deeply insightful. We would now like to open the floor for discussion. If anyone has any questions or anything you would like to share, please unmute your mic. You can also type it in the chat box and we will read it out aloud.
Due to the paucity of time, without a doubt, both the lectures were very interesting. But since we have overshot the time a little, we would only take 3-4 questions. For the rest, we'll provide you with our professors' email IDs and you can contact them. And we'll take 3-4 quick questions, and those who want to ask them, you can unmute or write in the chat box.
I think we are exhausted. We actually overshot our time. Then in the beginning also, we started a little late. So processing takes a while.
Actually, yes, of course. If you have any questions, you can mail us, and we will. I'm sure Smita will also agree.
Absolutely, you can mail us. There's no doubt about it. If you have a query, we are here. If you can think of it, whether from and as it's been just mentioned, that we only took 2 sources into account. One text. There's so many of them. Just one text and some inscriptions and a whole range of sources and documents have gone missing, and we are looking from the world of ancient India. So if you were to come to medieval and modern, there's so much more. But this was just to give you a glimpse of how you should be conducting research. I mean, the kind of questions that both Shatrupa and I have thrown across, I think those are far more important. Once you've understood the process of critiquing, questioning, and then exploring, things become easy. The last point, I think, Shatrupa, you would agree to it. There are many times that we go on with our research and questions pop up out from the research, from the explorations. For instance, in my own case, I was looking at normalization of violence as one of the important things, but its contestation came up only through my own study. So, there are things, you know, you have to keep on going back and forth in your research, especially if you're doing a research, not just a research paper, if you're doing a research project or if you're, you know, working towards a degree, higher degree. It's a very osmotic process. But for the research also, it has to be a little more nuanced than our writing class assignments. It has to be definitely a little more nuanced. And I think this is, Anushka, if I'm not wrong, we are just at the third level right now, from what is research, what is a research question, to the use of sources, and then of course the whole idea of style, of writing down how you process your ideas, and then doing it in a final paper. So it is like 6 lectures given to them, and then they should be in a position to write some research paper. I think in future we would keep that in mind, that research production comes out of it also in a gap of a month or so. If it were done in the first semester, then by second semester, they could have been more equipped to do it.
Yes, ma'am, definitely, ma'am. I agree with you, and I'm sure everyone who's heard these lectures will remember you and all the others who guided them when they're doing their researches. And I guess you're right. Everyone is assessing the information. I think we should give them some time to before they reach out for doubts. And on this note, I think I should ask Samvidhan to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Anushka Di. I feel grateful to have this opportunity to present vote of thanks today. We would like to express our heartfelt gratitude to both the speakers for sharing such useful information and insight into the process of writing a research paper. I'm pretty sure the previous knowledge that you both gave us will definitely help us in our studies and the future endeavors. We would also like to thank our faculty and friends for being such a wonderful audience. Lastly, I would like to apologize to you all. The session was so intriguing that it took more than estimated time and we didn't realize. Inconvenience caused is deeply regretted. Thanks for being patient with us. Once again, I thank you all for your cordial cooperation. Thank you. The participants may now start leaving.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you for being a good audience. And we're looking forward to your questions on mail. So, the most
Absolutely. We're looking forward to the questions. Something I think it may sound very academic, but it can be great fun also. Once you start getting into it, it's actually it's fun. It is revelation. Every moment a new thing pops up. It's such excitement. Even at my age, I think I feel I have that childlike curiosity. What more? That is what happens. You'll enjoy it once you get on to doing it.
Yeah, definitely.
Of course. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. We leave now. Thank you so much for giving us the opportunity. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye, ma'am.